And congratulations on the acclaim for your film. And,
thanks, it's going okay so far.
I'm really struck by something that Claude says at the end of the movie when he's talking about time stopping in his life. Because there's an essay that he wrote that he published it, Irving Howe published it, and it's about, it was written at the time of the TV series Holocaust, in which he talks about the abyss of that moment that we just can't comprehend what happens, you know, in the moment of death for the people who are in the gas chambers. So it seems to me that there's a link there between his intense identification and this feeling that he has of time in his life stopping. Does that seem right to you?
Yeah, I mean, that's right. Aside from, you know, being a great filmmaker, Claude is one of the great existentialist intellectuals of French society. So, you know, he very much approached the making of Shoah on a conceptual basis and gave a lot of thought as to how he could represent this thing. The series that you mentioned, Holocaust, you know, the American series that preceded Shoah, he really hated it. And he felt that it was everything that he didn't want his film to be. I feel sometimes like he at once understood what he was embarking upon when he began work on Shoah and didn't understand. He seemed to immediately realize that this was going to be a mammoth undertaking, but he didn't quite have the sense, you know, as he says at the beginning of the film, he knew nothing about the Holocaust, he knew just the top line facts, 6 million Jews had been killed. So as I feel that as he embarked into it, he was simultaneously developing a process of how he was going to tell this story.
And the development of the that process consisted of finding a form to accommodate the fact that there is no way of being there at that moment. There is no way of nailing that one moment because the form of the film is kind of a circling.
Right? Yeah. Again, it loops back on itself and comes back to other points. You know, it's a very, as he says himself, he's a very meticulous, stubborn person. It's a very meticulously crafted film. And I think what one of the things that Shoah succeeds in doing is in really trying to convey that the Holocaust isn't history, you know, and that there is something quite comforting sometimes in the idea of history. When you see black and white photos of something that happened in the past, you can feel like, you know, that was then. You know, when you look back at the Romans, you know, and the barbarism of the Middle Ages, you can feel safe because it's at a distance. But because Shoah is shot in what was the present day of the 1970s, you know, you see that those sites of mass murder are still there. That you know, it's not something that happened in the past. It's something that happened and that could happen again.
There's an interesting debate that he got into with Jean-Luc Godard, French filmmaker, about Godard insisted that there has to be a photograph or some footage of the inside of the gas chambers. The Germans photographed everything. How could they not have photographed that? If I could just get a photojournalist into the archives in Moscow, where they probably took everything, I'm sure they'd be able to find it. And Claude's response was, if such photographs were found or if such footage was found, I would burn it immediately. It's a very provocative statement, but the reason being, we don't need proof. We don't need photographic proof.
Claude Lanzmann feels that the absence of European Jews is the proof. You know, it doesn't exist in a photograph. You know, the evidence is in the absence. So, and you know, those French intellectuals love to get into their debates. Mm-hmm. Marcel Ophuls too.
Yes.
Yeah. I mean, I will say just, you know, this isn't too much of a provocative statement. One of the things that I did try to do with this film was take Shoah out of the realm of academia, out of the realm of just being something that's intellectually debated. Mm-hmm. And I tried to make a film that would make this man and his work and the two are so interlinked, you know, without Lanzmann there's no Shoah, without Shoah there isn't Lanzmann. To make it something that's not, you know, that's not inaccessible, that's not intimidating. Yeah. And one of the things I found very rewarding is that at almost every screening of the film, and there have been a lot so far, people have come up to me afterwards and said, how can I see Shoah? Mm. Where can I get this film? How can I see it?
That's great.
So that was one of the principal things that I wanted to do. Mm-hmm. And I think that sometimes people feel that it's an intimidating work because of its reputation. Its reputation precedes it. It's a 9.5 hour long film. It's almost all talking heads. It's very slow in its pace. And for a lot of people, I just think that they think it's going to be very, very upsetting. It is very upsetting, you know. It's a horror film, but it's not an inaccessible film, you know.
Yeah, and it's one of those, it's a film, I'm sure that you have had this experience, you know, when you say, you know, you talk about Shoah, people will say, oh, well, I've never seen that myself, as if they want someone else to kind of see it for them, you know, as if the task of watching 9.5 hours is just too much.
Yeah, and it's not nowadays. I mean, people sit and watch 50 hours of TV shows on DVD, you know.
Yeah.
You can do it in a weekend or over the course of a week, you know. And so, I felt in some ways he was due a film.
That's true.
And he's 90 years old now. Mm-hmm. He's coming to the Academy Awards, mm-hmm. I guess. So it's nice that he'll have that moment. That he will, you know, walk the red carpet alongside his peers in Hollywood, and that people will talk about this work. You know, I do feel in some way it's timely as well. I mean, last week was International Holocaust Remembrance Day, and, you know, President Obama was talking about, you know, he said unquestionably anti-Semitism is on the rise globally, yes. And, you know, we are all Jews now, yes. He said. Attack on any faith is an attack on all faiths.
Yes.
So I think, you know, that's that in a way makes it a timely film. And I'm glad he's having this moment. You know.
Mm, as am I. And I think it's worth noting, by the way, that Claude strenuously objects to the term Holocaust. You know,
which is, he does, yes. I mean, that was something that I thought, you know, should I change using that, but having grown up in the UK,
well,
because of the connotations of the word, you know, its etymology links back to sacrifice,
yes.
And that was one of the reasons he absolutely didn't want to use that in his film. He instead chose Shoah, which is the Hebrew word for catastrophe. I respected that in subtitling of the film, but I'm not going to not use the word.
No, I just wanted to mention it, but that does have a bearing on something that's very potent in your film, which is the fact that you are giving us a very just portrait of him. He's not, you know, always a warm and fuzzy individual.
No, not often.
The moment that you have in the movie where he really resists talking about the confrontation that he and his assistant had, where they, you know, were beaten and where they lost that Belush camera. Is almost a softer version of, you know, moments, yes, that I'm sure you encountered.
But there were several reasons I wanted to leave that in there. Firstly was to show that this was an interview. This is an interview film. Yeah. This wasn't him sitting in front of the camera and dictating his memoirs. And it was a sometimes contentious interview. There are some things that he didn't want to talk about. There were some things that he was reluctant to talk about. And I think part of that was his age at 87. You know, he was very generous with his time to sit for a week and to talk in depth. And I think with that particular story, with Heinz Schubert,
yes,
he felt it didn't reflect very well on him, because it was a real low point. They lost the extremely expensive prototype camera, which would be hilarious by today's standards. It's a long cylinder, mm-hmm, that was hidden in a bag, but did the task. They lost that. He and his assistant were severely beaten. He was threatened with a lawsuit, you know, insanely. And it was just a real low point for him. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't think that reflects well on him. But of course, when you see it in the context of everything that he went through to make this piece of work, how he suffered, yeah, you know, how he really put everything into making this film, in that context, you know, you have admiration for him. And when we talk about Claude Lanzmann being a stubborn person, you know, that's where it becomes a positive attribute, because he's the kind of person,
exactly,
who would say, you know, I'm not going to give up. So many filmmakers would give up when they're facing a lawsuit and they've been hospitalized and they've lost the camera. You know, that kind of dogged persistence is what drove him over this more than a decade to make this piece of work. You know, this isn't a film that could have been made, this film couldn't have been made by a shrinking violet. You know, it took someone who was tough, who was stubborn, and who could also stand up to his financiers, who I think frankly thought that he'd lost his way, that this was never going to be a film, as 2 years became five, became seven, became ten, who said to him, just make a film, make it 2 hours long and just deliver it so we have something. You know, but he was so single-minded in his vision of what this piece of work should be. And because of that, you know, Shoah has endured as the film that it is today. That's why people consider it to be the greatest documentary ever made, consider it to be the most important Holocaust film that it ever made. You know, all of those aspects of his personality, of his character, went into making Shoah such a singular work.
Yeah. No, I mean, it's striking when, you know, I've had moments when people have complained about how difficult he is. And like, are you kidding? You know, this is the man who made Shoah. Yeah. He gets to be as difficult as he wants to be for the rest of his life. Yeah.
And, you know, I'm nobody, and he agreed to give me a week of his time, and he didn't ask for any money. He didn't demand creative control of the interviews. So, you know, I'm very honored that he agreed to sit and talk with me about his life. You know, I'm really glad he did too.
I was interested in the fact that you compressed things down to this, as he says at the end, and that kind of says it all. It was an epic time, and yeah. you do have a powerful sense of him as an epic figure within that time.
Yeah, born in 1925, and when he says it was an epic century, you know, he's seen it.
He lived it.
One of the just like a nice little memory for me when we were filming, we went out for dinner one night, and then afterwards we walked through Montparnasse, where he lives in the 14th arrondissement in Paris. And he would show me the cafes where he and de Beauvoir would sit and smoke and read newspapers, you know, in the pre-television age. And, you know, it felt like, you know, history.
Mm.
It really felt like history, you know, so.
But I was interested in the fact that the moment, and I mean, this is a guy who has, you know, had his friendship with de Beauvoir and Sartre. He is an investigative journalist, met and interviewed everyone. Ran Le Temps Moderne, you know, with the two of them. And the thing that you focus on justly is his experience in the resistance and his relationship with his father.
Well, I felt in the structure of the film that I really wanted to focus on the story of how he made Shoah, you know, beginning in 1973 and ending in 1985. That was my structure for the film, because that was also what we could illustrate. What we would be able to illustrate. And it's the most interesting period of his life. But I felt that there was a way that we could do it, that we could also flash back to several key moments of his past and see how they link to the experiences of him making Shoah. So the fact that he fought as a teenager in the resistance and killed Nazis as a part of an ambush is important, because it tells you that when he approaches the film Shoah, it's, you know, the Holocaust is not an abstract concept for him. You know, he was a Jew in France from 1939 to 1945, so he was at risk. If he were caught, if he were captured, he would have been killed. So that, of course, informs the film that he goes on to make. You know, when he's sitting as close as you and I are sitting, when he's sitting opposite a former SS officer who on a beautiful day in June and July would wake up and kill 10,000 Jews, and then go to sleep happily and wake up the next day and do it again, you know, Lanzmann is having to give money to that person. He's having to smile and say, you know, I understand, I don't judge you, of course, you know, and he did it because he was killing them with his camera, you know. He knew how important it was to get their testimony, and if he hadn't done that, we wouldn't know some of the things that we now know about Treblinka and Auschwitz and Sobibor. That was the first thing. And then the second thing, you know, I wanted him to talk, obviously, about his relationship with de Beauvoir and Sartre, because, you know, it's an important link to French history, to world history. But I thought it would be best to do that in a way that talks about their support in terms of the years that he spent making Shoah, because sometimes he doesn't want to talk about it. He did a Q&A last month in Haifa, and somebody asked about that, and he just said, no, I don't want to talk about it, you know. But here, you know, in terms of the support that they offered, you know, he says to de Beauvoir, she never let me lose hope, never, you know, seemed very powerful. So I wanted to keep it, though, within that structure of his journey. And more broadly, I really wanted the film to be about his emotional journey, rather than, you know, I mean, it's obviously a film about how he made Shoah, but I didn't want it to be a kind of academic making of doc. I wanted to really document the making of Claude Lanzmann, you know, how doing this work made him as a person and made him into the person that he is today, which is to say, you know, a dark and saddened individual who was deeply marked by the process of doing this work, you know. He says that, you know, it was months of bereavement after he finished the film, when he finally let it go and it was done and he ended it. But it seems to me like decades of bereavement.
Well, it's worth noting that, you know, many of the clips that you include are from satellite films that he's made since Shoah. Though he's made several films since Shoah, but the only one that's differently conceived and that's of new footage is Sahal, the film about the Israeli Air Force.
Actually, almost all of the footage is previously unseen footage. None of it is from,
yes.
In my film, yes.
Yes.
You know, for those who haven't seen Shoah, there's obviously the scene in the barber shop when Avram Bomber, it just can't go on, which is such a powerful scene. But almost everything else that you see, the footage in the Bronx in the, you know, 1970s, the footage at Tel Aviv at the beach, outtake footage with the Nazis and with Avram Bomber and Philip Mueller telling the story about the 600 boys, all of that was newly digitized footage from the US Holocaust Memorial Museum. So, you know, I wanted to restore a lot of that footage to help tell his own story.
Yes. I'm just thinking of, there's an image of Yonkarsky on the couch, there's,
yes,
Mermelstein, and Mermelstein is the subject of the last film, The Last of the Unjust.
Yes.
Karski, he did, yeah, the Karski.
I didn't want to include them, you know, in a big way, because they're the subject of their own separate films, you know.
Right.
So, you know, I tried to find footage that would be indicative, but at the same time new. You know, I didn't want it just to use footage from Shoah. I wanted this to be a new film. So almost everything is new, but that scene with Avram Bomber I felt was so important because it in a concise way shows you what he went through with the survivors, and it also shows you a tender side of someone who's not really known for being tender. He spent a lot of time with the survivors beforehand, talking to them without a camera, without a notepad, just hearing their stories the first time, and then, you know, when you see him holding Bomber's hand, you know, he helped them. I don't really know how to say it, but excite them up, help them try to build up the confidence to tell their stories. And for many of them, it was the first time that they sat in front of a camera and told their experiences of being in the death camps and being in the concentration camps during the war. You know, it strikes me that one of the things that's quite shocking about Shoah, watching it today, is that there's this idea of seeing Holocaust survivors now that we're quite comfortable with, of seeing people in their 70s, 80s, 90s, often with white hair, reflecting on the past. But when you watch Shoah, you're seeing people who are in their 40s and 50s, who in some cases still have jobs, are still going about their lives, you know, talking about events that happened not that long ago, you know. At the time that he did this work, nobody was really doing anything like that. It's one of the reasons that Shoah was so shocking when it came out. You know, people sat in the cinema just completely aghast. What they were hearing for the first time.
Well, there was also quite a bit of controversy about the very idea of interviewing members of the Sonderkommando, that, you know, if they did that, then how could they possibly be reliable, was the idea, right?
Yeah, which is tough, you know. Yeah. And you still see Shoah's influence today. I mean, you see it in films like The Look of Silence and in films like Son of Saul, you know, very heavily influenced by Lanzmann's work.
I wonder if anyone has any questions before.
This immense project, 12 years, 200 hours of film, how was it finally financed?
So I'll repeat that question. The show is such an immense project, 12 years and, you know, 200 hours of film, and how was it financed?
In terms of financing, initially he got a grant from the Israelis, from Elif Haraven, who was working for the Israeli government at the time. They kind of ran out of patience with him, and then he got a grant from the French. Mitterrand gave him some money. The French kind of ran out of patience with him. It was sort of an ongoing process of burning bridges, is how I would best describe it. And he you know, begged and pleaded with people to give him money. He put his own financing into it. It was a real struggle. I mean, that was one of his real struggles, making the film financially. And of course, you know, when we talk about him filming it, it was filmed on film, physically on film. You know, I've seen all the canisters. And at the end, when the film was released, he was completely flat broke. And he, I think I remember him reading a line in his book where he said his hope was just that he wouldn't live the rest of his life in immense poverty, you know, that the film would maybe eventually recoup, you know, but he got, you know, he got some grants, but he didn't, you know, it was a very tough journey for him. A question?
In the your movie, there are two chronological years, 1966 and 1973, the years of the Six-Day War and the Yom Kippur War, one of the biggest attempts to the destruction of Israel and the Jews. Anything influence on him? And my second question, there was any event that decided him that that's enough and that's the end of my work on this?
In terms of, was the Six-Day War an influence of him? Well, I think, you know, this is a question that has relevance to you. I think that the Six-Day War commenced as his first film, Book Why Israel, which you see a little bit of at the beginning of my film, was having its world premiere at the New York Film Festival. So Lanzmann was actually here in New York, about to have the premiere of Why Israel here in New York, when the Six-Day War commenced, and it was, he said it was terrible because nobody was talking about his film. You know, I say that without no pun intended, but so yeah, of course, it had an effect on him. With your second question about when he reached the end point, you know, he said that he just realized one day the film was done. He couldn't describe it. It was just. He just knew, and there's actually a separate story to this. I mean, if I made a decision just to focus on Claude Lanzmann's story, but there are other stories involving, of course, all the other people who made the film, his cameraman, his assistant, his editor. The day that he went into the edit suite, as I'm told, and said, "That's it, the film is done," his editor shaved all her hair off. She just couldn't, I think, you know, she was one of those people who just felt that this film was never going to be finished. You know, he had this vision in his mind, and it was difficult for other people to see. And you know, they spent 5 years editing it, 5 years editing it on film. You know, which I find mind-boggling. There was a question right at the back. I mean, like literally in the back row, in the shadows. Yeah.
Calling you from the shadows. Thank you very much for this documentary. It's a three-part question. I'd like to know.
Three-part question, okay.
Well, what is the basis of your interest in immersing yourself in this project?
Yes.
Secondly, has Mr. Lanzmann seen the final product?
Yes.
And thirdly, you have a lot of footage from a week. Do you plan to do a follow-up to this documentary?
Okay, so what was my interest in this? Well, I come from a film background, and I'm a print journalist by training. I've interviewed almost every major documentary maker working today, from Pennebaker to Maisels to Errol Morris, Barbara Koppel, Lucy Walker, Rory Kennedy. So my background had been in writing about film and in documenting non-fiction cinema. And when I came across Claude Lanzmann's story, I just couldn't believe that there hadn't been a film about him. I, like a lot of people, knew of Shoah and then saw Shoah, but it was really when I began reading about him and his life that I thought, you know, this man has an incredible story. I mean, not just what he went through with Shoah, but the fact that he was, you know, close to de Beauvoir, Sartre, a war hero, friends with Frantz Fanon, editor of Le Temps Moderne, traveled the world, had this huge kind of Hemingway-esque life of travel and adventure. So really, you know, I just felt that there should be a film on him. I had seen Errol Morris's film, The Fog of War, around the time that the idea came to me, and I thought that that approach would work here, that really I just needed to sit with him and have him talk about his life. You have to remind me what the second part of the question was.
And then has Mr. Lanzmann
seen Yes, Claude has seen the film. He said last week he thinks it's rather good, which is praise unheard of, you know. Before, this was after the Oscar nomination. Before that he said, I don't object to the film.
The last part was whether you would do any follow-up with it.
You have footage from the
whole... Oh, yes, yeah. Well, actually, it was... So we have about 5.5 to 6 hours footage with Claude, which is not a huge amount to make a film from. You know, I felt it would be better to make a short, powerful film here. In terms of this being a 70, 80, 90-minute film, my feeling was that it wouldn't have sustained, and it would have been less powerful. It would have covered the same emotional points, it just would have been longer. I don't know, it could have been a feature film, but my sense was just that it wouldn't have been a very good feature film. It would be much more impactful as a short, emotional film about this emotional journey that he went on.
Hi, yes. Hi, I'm a graduate student getting a master's in Holocaust studies and genocide, but I started as a ballerina, an actress and filmmaker and director, and I still do. I think it's, from what I gather, it's a film about truth and what it takes to get to the truth. Yes. But your audience, was your audience targeted at to the scholar, to the filmmaker, to the general public? What was your target audience? I'm just curious, there's so many things, and when you study the Shoah, as he discovered, there's more layers, and it seems to never end, so I get his...
Well, it was definitely the general public. You know, and that's part of the reason that you have this short intro sequence at the beginning of the film where you contextualize, or I contextualize, what Shoah is for an audience that haven't seen it. It's a film about the Holocaust. It's considered a groundbreaking film about the Holocaust. It's made by a man called Claude Lanzmann. He's a difficult person, but he's also a genius, and this film's a masterpiece. And I think it's important to have that at the beginning, because I knew that once we launched into his story, I would want to stay with his story, and I wouldn't want to leave him, that I'd want the film to be him speaking in his own words. But before that, you know, you do need to make it a bit accessible for people. And I feel that Shoah, his film, has been very well covered by academia. There are numerous books on it, by Stuart Liebman, by Sue Weiss. There are numerous papers that have been written about it. So I didn't want to make a purely academic film. I feel that academia, you know, in terms of it being for scholars, I didn't really want to make a film for scholars, you know. I wanted to make a film that the general public would understand, you know, this man and his story, yeah.
I was fascinated by the character of how difficult it was for the father to speak, and he kept at it. And then when you spoke to Lanzmann about when he was beaten up, and how difficult it was for him to speak.
Yeah.
I'll just summarize that for people in the back who might not have gotten it. There's a parallel being drawn here in the film between the moment with Abraham Bamba and the difficulty that he has speaking about his experience, and then Claude's difficulty speaking about the experience of being beaten and chased out with his assistant.
Yeah, I mean, it wasn't deliberate in the moment when I was interviewing him, but obviously it was something that I considered, you know, when we were editing the film. There are similarities and there are differences. Where I would say that there's a difference is, I think that Abraham Bamba very much wanted to talk about what he'd been through. He just couldn't. He just literally couldn't. He was trying, and he just couldn't. It was so painful for him to do that. With Claude, I felt it was a bit different. You know, he kind of didn't want to speak about it. Not that he couldn't. He didn't, as I said before, he didn't think that the story reflected very well on him. He was tired from doing the interview. And I had to kind of pick my battles with him a little bit. And that was one where I felt like, you know, Claude, it's really important that we talk about this. It's really important that's in there. But in terms of similarities, you know, what Lanzmann does with Shoah is he takes survivors back to sites of memory, and he makes them relive their experiences, sometimes in very physical ways. you know, taking a man who was forced to cut the hair of women in the gas chamber and putting him in a barbershop and putting scissors in his hands, taking a man who used to drive a train and putting him on a train and making him redo the journey to Treblinka, taking a man who was a boy on a boat and putting him back on a boat. And in a sense, what I'm doing here with Claude, 30 years after he made Shoah, is returning him, although not physically, returning him mentally to a site of memory and taking him back to these events of 30 years ago and re-immersing him in those events, you know. And that, I think, was an emotional experience for all of us to do that, for me and for him. You know, some of those events necessarily are not going to be very pleasant for him. A lot of those events, you know, nearly drowning, having to sit with survivors, having to sit with Nazis, being at risk, having pressure from all angles, you know. I took him back to that place.
Survivor is another word that he objects to, right?
Yeah, he objects to survivors as well. I mean, you know, he approaches it from a very, he says there are no survivors from the gas chamber, which is correct. And his film is about death in the gas chamber. But the few Sonderkommando who did survive are necessarily survivors. You know, again, that was kind of in the realm of academia that I was trying to navigate around when I was making the film, to not make it be an intellectual debate. So, you know, I use a label that says, you know, Auschwitz survivor. Right. That's kind of my choice. He wouldn't have necessarily done that. But again, that goes back to your point about wanting to make an accessible film, you know.
Let's do one more.
I was curious, what ever happened to the Nazis? Were they ever prosecuted?
Well, let's take Heinz Schubert, for example. Whose family, you know, attacked Lanzmann. Heinz Schubert had already been in prison. You know, one of the things that was surprising to me making this film is, I guess I had this idea in my mind that all of the Nazis that were found guilty were just sent off to prison for life. In the case of Heinz Schubert, as I recall, he was sentenced to death and then his death sentence was commuted to 10 years. So he had gone to prison, he'd served his tenure, and then he'd come out. And was just living again in society, you know. Some of the Nazis that were guards in the camps got relatively short jail sentences and came back out. So, I mean, that's one of the reasons that they didn't want to talk. You know, Schubert had been in jail, and he and his family were deeply mistrustful of anyone, even people posing as academics, you know.
Yeah, sure. One of those other questions. Yeah.
In German. I mean, Claude speaks English, French, and German, so he was speaking in German with Schubert. Yeah.
And he actually spent time in Germany right after the war.
Yeah. He taught in Berlin at the Berlin Free
University. Yeah.
And he has a great fondness for Berlin. The Berlin Festival gave him its honorary Golden Bear Award, which is what you see at the end of the film.
I think that's great that he's going with you and walking the carpet. That's going to be it's a very special thing for him.
His film Shoah was never nominated for an Academy Award, so I think it is nice that he'll be there.
Yeah. Well, thank you all for coming. Thank you.